So we have a YouTube viewer, and they say that they're taking both estrogen and progesterone after bilateral orchiectomy. And they're having hot flashes that hit them at night, but they're pretty severe and they come every 20 minutes. They would like to know if you recommend anything that they can take because they're already on estrogen and progesterone.
Estrogen and progesterone are probably the most powerful anti-hot flash medicines, but there are some other agents such as an antidepressant called Effexor or a neuroleptic called Gabapentin, or another name or another type of neuroleptic is called Lyrica. And these medicines are pretty effective. So they sometimes will have side effects. They are not universally effective for hot flashes. I'd estimate that about half of the men that take them say they see a real benefit. The estrogen is my favorite first step. You have to warn people, of course, that they could get some breast tenderness or breast enlargement, and they can avoid that if they do a brief radiation treatment to the nipples. Progesterone can be converted chemically into testosterone in the body. So if the prostate cancer is not under complete control, I would hesitate to use any progesterone in men with prostate cancer. But estrogen is probably the best and most likely to work. But when it's not working, then these other medicines that I mentioned could be effective.
What is it about the antidepressant or Lyrica or Gabapentin? What is the mechanism of action that would alleviate the hot flashes?
Someone may know the answer to that. I don't. I think this was discovered empirically in men that were on these medicines for other purposes, and so they're used off-label for that purpose. But how the hot flashes are controlled with the medicine specifically, I don't know the mechanism of action.
We have another viewer who's wondering if surgery would be a good option for them. They have a PSMA without any lymph node involvement, Gleason 9, and a PSA of 12.
So basically a high-risk patient. I'm not a big fan of surgery pretty much for any kind of prostate cancer, but I'm even less of a fan in men with high-risk prostate cancer. The problem is there's a high incidence of positive margins, and that means the surgeon goes in with the intention of cutting the whole prostate out and getting all the cancer, but unfortunately they leave the cancer behind. Because the cancer started to get out through the edge of the gland, and the surgeon is unable to cut around the cancer, so he leaves cancer behind. And then these men end up needing radiation soon after the surgery, which is a difficult proposition. These men are trying to recover their urinary continence, and they want to get all the cancer and get radiated, but they don't want to radiate too quickly because they want the operation to have healed. Men with high-risk prostate cancer, I think, are even more problematic in terms of doing surgery than, say, an intermediate risk category where they're more likely to be able to get all the cancer out.
Hey everyone, it's me, Alex, and our mascot, Hunter. You can check out his Instagram, Sir Hunter the Dow, at the link below. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, and in fact, if this dog high fives me, high five, high five. Can you high five me? Thank you. You have to subscribe. Go subscribe to the YouTube channel. He even thinks it's awesome. Also, don't forget to visit our website, PCRI.org.